Hello everybody, Ryan Kurzak here from Asheville Vedic Astrology. Today I want to review some basics, what I consider to be one of the most profound yet simplest techniques available to astrologers. And that is simply looking for the confluence between what a planet means as a house lord, and all those multiple influences on that area of life that you want to know about. For example, it's easy to look at a chart and to think that all we need to do is go to the fifth house so that we can understand a person's children, their creativity, their relationship to the IRS, whatever it might be, that is represented by the fifth house. And a lot of people will look at that fifth house, and if there's no planets there, they don't know what to do. Or they might see all malefic planets influencing that fifth house and think there's all kinds of difficulty going towards children. And the problem occurs when we just look at this one area only, and we don't look at the chart on a broader scale. Because in order to understand how a person's creativity is going to express, how their mind is going to be, how they're going to work through problems, what their legacy is going to be, which are all fifth house matters. You need to look at the influences on the fifth house. You also need to see what planet is ruling the fifth house, and then find that in the chart and determine, well, what's going on with that planet. And you tally up the good and the bad. And from there, you also need to understand what are the karakas, or what are the indicators, for the particular area of life in question. So again, for a fifth house influence, that would be Jupiter, especially when we're thinking of things like children or creativity, or ability to use the mind in a wise fashion. And this is where it gets complicated, but it's really not complicated, it's just tedious. Because once you line up, okay, this is what's going on in the fifth house. I see that we have Venus and we have Mercury influencing that fifth house. These are two benefic planets. They're going to help the person manage the affairs of the fifth house, Mercury. They're going to help a person make better choices in regards to fifth house matters, Venus. That's good. So the fifth house by itself is supported. Step number one. And the house, I consider to be like the environment. And the lord of that house is the consciousness, or the energy that you, or whoever's chart you're talking about, how that person consciously works with that area. And this is why we have to use confluence, because you might have this fifth house strongly supported by Venus and Mercury, but maybe that fifth house lord is debilitated, or maybe that fifth house lord is hemmed in between two malefic planets, a waning moon and Saturn, for instance. What does that tell me? That tells me that when the person starts in life, that naturally they're going to have a lot of grace and a lot of gentleness and benefic influence on their baseline capacity for fifth house matters. Why? Because those two planets, Venus and Mercury, the benefics, are influencing the fifth. But then I know, when I look at the fifth house lord, that they might not manage that area well. So it's just like if someone gives you a very fancy car, but you don't know how to drive it, so you wreck it. Or you might start out with a very strong, robust constitution. First house matters, sixth house matters, strong supported first and sixth house. But your first house lord or your sixth house lord is debilitated, hemmed in between malefics, getting starved through Lajitadiya Vashtas. That's going to show that the individual, the choices they're going to make, will harm that house or harm that area of life. That's the way we want to think about it. So the house itself is the potential, the capacity that we bring in, the environment of the areas we're considering. How we work with it is related to the planetary lord of that house. Again, another example. with 10th house matters, which deals with status, profession, career, the activity that we take within the world. Well, maybe that 10th house has a starved Mars in it, Lajjatati Avashta of starved. And again, those of you who don't know about the Lajjatati Avashtas, I highly recommend that you do learn about them because they fill in a lot of the details about a chart. I've written about them. There's a whole chapter on them in The Art and Science of Vedic Astrology, Volume 2. There's also a downloadable course on ashevilleVedicAstrology.com where we go into all these Lajjatati Avashtas. But those of you who do know about it, we'll continue. So we have a starved, frustrated Mars in the 10th house, which means that the person might have a lot of aggression towards their status, towards their profession, or they might have to deal with a lot of aggression within their profession. It makes it harder for them to be active in the world without feeling like they're being attacked or having to go up against aggressive influences. But now let's say the Lord of that 10th house is in good dignity, and the Lord of that 10th house is delighted, again, another Lajjatati Avashta, delighted by Jupiter. So it may be that you can say, you are going to have a lot of problems within your career, especially with status, being challenged in regards to your prestige or your ability to act within the world. But I can see that because the Lord of that house is so strong, that you'll be able to manage it well. You'll be able to consciously take steps to dance around the difficulties, to come out ahead. So always remember, with this idea, it's that first you have to look at all the things that represent the area of life that you're considering. If we're still talking about the 10th house, that's going to be, number one, the 10th house itself. Number two, the Lord of the 10th house. And to take it a step further, the natural Karaka, we could use the sun. So those are three things. And you want to look at all three of those things to see what's going to go on in regards to the person's fame and status and capacity to act within the world. So it's not black and white. And the differences will occur during different dasha cycles. Maybe a person is in a positive sun cycle, which is going to help their career. Maybe now they're in the cycle of their lord of the 10th house. And let's say that lord is getting harmed. Well, when you run the dasha of that planet, then the career goes down a little bit because that lord is being harmed. So this is how we need to look at the chart dynamically. Not just trying to say there's one thing that we look at for a particular area of life. The chart is dynamic. The chart has many different layers and subtleties to it. And you have to know what the karakas, what the indicators of what you want to study or understand. You have to be able to look at them from all the different angles of house lord, the house itself, the karaka of the house. And that's just to begin, because then after that you want to take it into the vargas, the divisional charts, to get the full picture of what's going on. So this idea of what is the best technique? Well, number one, know what each planet means as a natural karaka, as a natural indicator. Number two, know what the houses represent, the houses themselves. Number three, learn how to assess influences on houses. Learn how to assess influences on house lords, planets in general. And those can be things as easy as combinations of a benefic planet with a cruel planet, a malefic planet, or a planet in a difficult house, like the 6th, 8th, or the 12th. And all these things have been covered on this channel in the 52 series, the 52 video series on the basics of astrology, the introduction, so you can go back and review that. When it comes to karakas, again, going back to The Art and Science of Vedic Astrology, Volume 2, the last 20 pages or so focus on karakas. They focus on, for example, what does the sun mean in the first house in the Rashi, the birth chart, where it represents the body, the personality, the health. What does Saturn mean in the second house? What is it a karaka of? Well, thriftiness, wealth from hard work, working within rock quarries, things of this nature. What does Venus in the 12th house represent? It can represent nursing homes, one's mistress, the mother's father, vacations. These are all things that Venus as a natural karaka indicates. And so it goes on through each house with each planet. And then it even goes into the Vargas, the divisional charts. And these are based on manuals from classes that I've done and given to students, and also the downloads that we have on our website. Within the Vargas, we want to know, what does the sun mean in the Hora? Well, it represents the consistent approach to meeting one's responsibilities, the capacity to maintain wealth. If we want to know what Mars represents in the D9, well, it shows the capacity to compromise in marriage, one's brother and sister-in-law, one's community, the capacity to logically do what is right within one's marriage path, good judgment. So each Varga, I think it goes up into the D30, yes, up through the Trimsumsha, has a planet, and that planet represents something within that Varga. Using the Trimsumsha, the D30, we want to look at Jupiter. What can Jupiter represent as a karaka? It represents the liver, the brain, the reproductive system, the energy of the gallbladder, the endocrine system, the hypothalamus, the ether element, and so on. These are just some things. And I put all these together in the appendix of the Art and Science of Vedic Astrology, Volume 2, so that astrologers can have a desk reference. And I use it myself all the time. That's one of the main reasons I write these books, is so that I have my own notes right there, visible, so I can go to them when I need them. So first of all, knowing what the planets mean as karakas, knowing what the houses mean, and then taking the time to go through and think about, all right, well, the house lord looks good. The house itself doesn't look so good. The natural karaka, maybe it's good, maybe it's not. We have to judge these things. And that's based on dignity, that's based on Ajataya Vashtas, that's based on Shadbala. And when we can synthesize these together, and it takes a while to think about them all, contemplate them, then we have a clearer, fuller picture of how is the person whose chart we're looking at going to interact in the world. What are they starting with? How are they going to work with that? And this is one of those reasons the Parivartana Yoga, I probably didn't pronounce that right, and I get criticized a bit for my lack of Sanskrit capacity to pronounce things, so I apologize if I did not pronounce that right. But what is this? This is the exchange of one house lord into another house. So it's, for example, the first lord in the fifth house and the fifth lord in the first house. Why is that considered an important yoga? Well, a lot of people make a big deal about it, thinking that that's supposed to give extreme success. It only gives extreme success if both of those planets are in good dignity and well supported. Otherwise, the reason it's such an important yoga is because it's a dual indicator, meaning that if you have the first lord and the fifth, that's going to give a strong connection to fifth house affairs, the personality, the body, the self getting involved in fifth house matters. When you have the fifth lord in the first, well, now we have the same thing coming in the opposite direction. So they essentially, in a sense, will mean very similar things. And when aspects of a chart say the same thing, that is more likely to occur. And the reason I try not to get too caught up in whether this is a great yoga or not is because both of those planets can be in bad shape, which means that there's greater strength for something negative to occur. So it's only when those planets are in a good situation and the natural karakas of those planets are also in a good situation. So finally, one last time, let's consider this. We want to look at the house itself to see what is the capacity that a person has around that area of life represented by that house. If you need to review that, go back and watch the videos on this channel on the house you're curious about. Or get the book, The Art and Science of Vedic Astrology, Volume 1, where we list out the houses and what they mean. But there are plenty of other astrology books that do that too. So pick up any book that has the houses in it and review it. Number 2, consider the house lord. How is it doing? That will tell you how is the person going to consciously use or work with or direct the affairs of that house. Are they going to manage it well? Then you want to look at the karaka, the natural karaka, the indicator for that particular house. Again, for example, Jupiter can represent children. It can represent wealth. The sun can represent status. It can represent health. Saturn can represent illness, enemies, and so on. So there are particular indications for each planet as a karaka. And if you want to learn more about that, again, just research it. It's all over the internet. Or if you want to have it handy, get the Art and Science of Vedic Astrology Volume 2. It's all in the back. Study that and memorize it. And I have found that the karaka, the general indicator, the planetary indicator, that typically relates to the archetypical form. For example, the sun can represent an authority figure such as the father. That's more like how you relate to that kind of energy in general. The ninth and tenth house, depending on what system you follow, will represent your personal father. And the ninth or tenth lord will also dial in a little bit more. So as far as this technique goes, it's really about knowing what everything means and learning how to judge them or assess them and then synthesize to see the foundation a person starts with and how they're going to work with that foundation. Okay, so consider this. I look forward to any feedback. I would like to say, just before we conclude here, as it's been a very busy time, and I've gotten numerous requests for astrological consultations, and I'm currently booking about 3 to 4 months from the date that you probably listen to this. And as I've mentioned before, I'm not an urgent care astrologer. So if you need help sooner and you do want to have a session with me, you might need to contact someone else. I recommend Michael Reed of AuthenticAstrology.com, Corey Dowds of EyeOfTheVeda.com, Channing Ayers. Channing, you can find her information on my website, AshevilleVedicAstrology.com. Go to the Vedic Astrologers section and scroll down. Her email address is there. They may be able to work you in a little sooner. If you do want to work with me, that's fine. I appreciate that. Just please have some patience, both in regards to our capacity to write back to you, as well as to schedule. So we're not currently scheduling, but we are taking names for a wait list. And then after the first of the year, we'll go through that wait list, start asking if you still want a session, and then if so, we'll schedule it. But again, it's about 3 to 4 months out, so please have patience. And I hope you've enjoyed this video, and we'll be in touch soon. Thank you.